Morning.
Morning.
Theme for this year in the cathedral. Not just a title, not just a catchphrase, but what we're about. Building up itself in love. It's about building. It's talking about the body, the church being built up. And even as we're here Sunday after Sunday, we can look right out this back door and see the building progress on that facility, which will be our church building for years to come. And as we've gone on through the different seasons of the year, every theme of the week has been something to do with building. Sometimes about building in love and the aspects of that. Here in Easter season, we talk about resurrection life, that which is the center of Easter, and how even that resurrection life has a role of building different aspects in the church. Different virtues in the individual believer and in the church itself. This morning we talk about how resurrection life builds understanding. We have to understand building is a process. It doesn't happen instantly. As we see the building rise, they'll dig a hole first. Well, first they had to tear down the building that was there. I just noticed yesterday passing through. The old building is gone now. And then you have to dig a hole. And you have to pour the foundation. Once you pour the foundation, you can't just instantly start building things on it. It has to set for a while. When you start building the walls, you can't just automatically start doing the interior finishing. Because if you do the interior finishing before there's a roof, sayang, if it ever starts to rain again, everything will be ruined. It's a process step by step. And sometimes it's a deliberate process. Things have to be done correctly in order. And sometimes even a little settling, a little aging before you go to the next step. You don't start working with concrete the minute it's poured. It has to cure. And building is like that. And even as the Lord builds His church, He does it step by step, bit at a time. Even the story on the road to Emmaus, we see this. We see how the men going to Emmaus, one was named Simon, not Peter. You can read the whole story and see the details. It wasn't Simon Peter. Another Simon. And someone named Clopas. And they knew the facts. They knew the facts of what had happened in the last 3 days. They knew about how Jesus was crucified, how He had been a prophet. They knew all that. They knew that some women had seen the tomb was empty. They knew that some of the apostles had also gone and checked it out. They knew facts. But they had no understanding of the facts. They knew what was going on. They knew what had happened. But there was no understanding. Now that's understandable. Remember that for the Jewish mind of that day, and you know, what they had been taught for centuries, death and suffering and crucifixion was not on the Messiah's to-do list. It just wasn't what they expected Him to do. They expected Him, you know, yes, conquer Rome, check, He'll do that. Raise up the nation of Israel to be head over all the world, check, we'll do that. Bring us back our heavenly manna, daily feed, check, He'll do that. Dying, no, that's not on the list. So it's easy to understand why they didn't understand this. They had knowledge, but no understanding. So when Jesus first joined Himself to them, He had to explain certain things. But it was a process. It says twice there, He explained to them. And then later they were telling the others, He explained to us the Scriptures. And it's a process. It doesn't happen so quickly. And after the explaining, then it says He was known to them in the breaking of the bread. When the explaining first happened to them, it says, oh, notice how our hearts were burning when He explained. So sometimes explanation just gives us heartburn. Don't worry, we have antacids back here at the back if anybody gets heartburn from the explaining this morning. But our goal is to explain the truth, and then that's never enough. As I said, building is a process. After there's explanation, there's the breaking of the bread, which also opens our eyes. But it's a slow and deliberate process that happens, line upon line, precept upon precept. So what I want to do today is explain a bit about some of the core message of Easter. Not the entire message of Easter. That would take a long time. That's why it's 50 days. That's why it's 7 Sundays. But I want to explain something about Easter. I'm going to start off by beginning where last Wednesday night we talked for a few minutes about this, about how Easter and Lent are not two separate things. They're a continuing process again, but they have the same message. To help explain this, I'd like us all to stand up for a moment. Just for a moment. And now what I would want to do to begin with, if you were here Wednesday night, you know the routine. I want you to turn around 180 degrees. Face the back. This is what started in March 1, the Ash Wednesday, when the message was repent and turn to the Lord. Repenting means turning around 180 degrees. We had our backs to the Lord. We were facing the world and its systems. And the message of Lent is turn around. Forsake that following the world. Forsake your sins. And the song was, Eternal Lord of love, behold your church. Walking once more the pilgrim way of Lent. So let's all walk a little bit in place. Just, you don't have to really like a big high step, no goose stepping, but just sort of walk a little bit in place. Like we did in the month of March and half the month of April. Walking the pilgrim way of Lent. Part of Lent is fasting. Sometimes in our fasting, we go, okay, I'm going to fast. I'm going to give up something that I really like. I like soda. I like fries. I like this particular website. I'm going to fast these things for Lent. And so we think that in fasting these things for Lent, giving them up, it draws us closer to God. And we go through the first week and the second week, walking the pilgrim way of Lent. Oh, I want a French fry so bad. Please, can I just look at the website for just a second? I just have to know something. But we keep going. Hopefully we go through for 6 weeks. Finally, it's Easter. And on Easter we say, praise God, I can go back to the way things were before. I can eat my fries. I can drink my soda. I can spend all day looking at the website. And so we turn back to the way we were. Now please turn around and face the front again. Another 180 degrees. So before Lent started, you were facing this way. You turned around 180 degrees for Lent. Then on Easter Sunday, you turned back around. What's different? When you turn around 360 degrees, nothing has changed. You're facing the things of the world again. About? So nothing has really changed. Lent was like one thing. Okay, then Easter, something different. Go back around and do it the way it was before. See, that's what we're off with. That's not what Easter's about. You can sit down now. You look tired. Go ahead. Have a seat. But no sleeping, okay? The difference is Lent fasting is not just about giving up things we like. If we look at the writings of the church fathers, the early church, Lent fasting is about what we said, repenting, turning from our sins, rejecting the ways of the world and following the ways of God. And so when Lent is over, it's not time to turn back around. We're not saying, okay, now it's time to sin again. That's not the message of Easter. Not at all. But because we've sort of changed, sort of distorted the meaning of fasting, instead of giving up sin and embracing righteousness, we're just give up something I like just as a good practice for self-discipline, and then when it's Easter, the self-discipline's over. That's not what it's supposed to be. But because we kind of have that idea, we lose the real meaning. We lose the value of it. And so come Easter, we turn back around, and it's business as usual, and we're the same people we were on the end of February. The season of Lent has done nothing for us. So, first thing to understand this morning is the message of Easter is not just, Lent's over, now we can go back to business as usual. Actually, the message of Easter is also repentance. Easter is not the end of Lent and a new direction. It's a continuation of Lent. It's an elevation of what we learned there. Because on Pentecost Sunday, which is actually the 50th day of Easter, the last day of Easter, the message of St. Peter was, Repent. Sounds a lot like Lent, doesn't it? Acts 2:38. Peter says, repent and be baptized. That's Easter, still the Easter season, 50th day. Then later he said, repent and return. What we just did a while ago. Not 360 degrees. That's changing nothing. Return. You had your backs to the Lord before, you were facing the Lord. Now you've got your backs to Him. Return and face the Lord again. Walk towards His precepts. Walk towards His kingdom, towards His presence. And then in Acts chapter 3, which is still one of the readings which we often read in the Easter season, the second sermon that St. Peter preached was when he was, after he had healed the lame man, and after he said, repent and return, at the end of that sermon, he says, God has blessed you by sending His Son to turn you from your wicked ways. Again, you're turning. It's a Lent message, even though it's Easter, because the Easter season, the message of the Easter season, is not the opposite of Lent. It's the continuation. The continuation of Lent was identify these things in your life and turn from them. The Easter message continues that same. In our first reading today from 1 Peter chapter 1, most Bible scholars, people who study these things and give their lives, devote their lives to learning about them, they tell us that 1 Peter was started off as an Easter sermon, which was preached during the Paschal Vigil to those who were about to be baptized. And Peter is saying here on Easter Sunday morning, in 1 Peter there, and chapter 1, verse 14 to 16, he says, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance. See, lust is ignorant. Sin is ignorant. Remember what we're here today to get things explained to us, to receive knowledge and understanding. First thing we got to know, sin is ignorant. God never condones sin because it's just ignorant. He says, these lusts are yours in ignorance. But like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves in all your behavior, because it is written, be holy because I'm holy. Again, this is an Easter message, but St. Peter's talking about turn aside, reject all those lusts, all those passions for sin which you have, and be holy. Because I'm holy. Part of the Easter message. Another scripture which was always read during the Easter vigil is in Romans chapter 6. Again, the scripture which you're reading to the catechumens who are about to be baptized into the faith. The message which comes to them is from St. Paul in the church at Rome, the letter to the church at Rome, chapter 6. First he says, knowing this, our old self was crucified with Him, that our body might be done, a body of sin might be done away with. We should no longer be slaves to sin. We skip down to verse 11. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin. Sounds like Lent. What happened to Easter? Because this is still part of the Easter message. It goes on from here, but it never removes or does away with the Lent message. Dead to sin, alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey its lusts. Sounds a lot like 1 Peter. Turn aside from those lusts, those passions which lead you in the wrong direction. Do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourself to God as those alive from the dead, your members as instruments of righteousness. Members of your body just means the parts of your body. You can imagine, each of the parts of our body can be used for righteousness or for sin. Use your imagination. Think of every part of your body. Yeah, here's something that can be done for good. My hand can give alms to the poor. My hand can help someone. My hand can also do something to hurt somebody. All the parts of your body, again, use your imagination, can be used for good or wrong. Then in verse 14, sin shall not be master over you, for you're not under law but under grace. So again, we see that the message of Easter takes up the message of Lent. It doesn't replace it. Lent, or Easter, is about how God has dealt with death, how Christ came and destroyed death. But in order to destroy death, He first had to answer the issue of sin. Because the only reason death is here is because of sin. Death is the wages for sin. If there had been no sin, there would have been no death. Paul says death entered the world because of sin. So Christ, first of all, when he came to deal with sin, he dealt with it two ways. The first way he dealt with sin was to be sinless himself. Because if he had committed sin, he could not have offered his body a sacrifice to pay the debt for sin. But Christ was perfect. And the Lent message is that Christ lived a perfect life to be a sacrifice for sin. And that's what he did for us. But that Lent message without the Easter message is incomplete. Lent tells us that we should turn away from our sin. The Easter message tells us how. But the Easter message without Lent is impossible. Because if Christ had not dealt with sin, then he also could not have risen from the dead. And that's true with us. Unless we deal with sin in our lives, we can't avail of the resurrection of Christ. So we see in these illustrations here, hopefully we'll understand, the Easter message is not, okay, Lent's over, now sin is okay. Sin doesn't matter. That's not the Easter message. That's what sometimes we bring out, and it gets us into error, basically. The Easter message is not sin is okay. Sin doesn't matter. Sin matters. You know why sin matters? Doesn't matter whether or not sin separates you from God, heaven or hell. That's another issue. The unchangeable issue from the time of Adam to today until the day Jesus comes back, sin hurts people. When you steal from somebody, it hurts them. I've been robbed before. Any of you here been robbed? When I was working in the construction business, twice my tools were stolen. It hurt because you can't work unless you have tools. And you can't get money to buy tools unless you work. And it was a real problem there for a while. It hurts when you commit adultery. It destroys the families involved. Every sin hurts. That's why it's sin. God didn't say, I don't think I like this. I'm going to make it sin. He identified certain things as sin because they hurt people. They hurt the one who's sinning, and they hurt the ones that's being sinned against. That's why sin is wrong. It hurts people. So you can never say sin doesn't matter. Whether it's an issue of heaven or hell, that's for smarter people than me to decide. But I can tell you, sin hurts people. And that's why it matters. The message of Easter is not sin is okay. The message is sin is dealt with. That's what Jesus did. He dealt with sin. He did it two ways. One is he paid the price for sin. We said in the first reading there in 1 Peter, it said that we were redeemed by a great and precious price, the precious blood of Jesus. The first way that Jesus dealt with sin, he redeemed. Because as we said, there's a price for sin, it's debt. Each of us owed that debt of sin. Because all have sinned, fallen short of the glory of God. But Jesus redeemed us. He paid the price for us. Now let me give you a brief illustration to help explain. My goal this morning is to explain. Hopefully the illustration of turning around 180 degrees and 360 degrees helps explain the difference between just stopping at Lent and having a whole different thing for Easter and understanding that Easter continues Lent. We can't just turn back around and pretend like Lent never happened. But redemption, Jesus redeemed us. Redemption means you own something, it's yours legitimately, but somebody else suddenly has a claim on it and you have to pay a price to get it back. That's redemption. For instance, let's say you have a car. You're driving the car. And this car is like Herbie the Love Bug. Anybody ever saw that movie, The Love Bug, Herbie? Remember Herbie, some kind had a mind of its own. The guy driving, whether it's Dean Jones in the 1960s, when I forget who was in the remake, he'd turn the wheel this way, but Herbie would go that way. Herbie would do whatever he did. Let's say that you're the car, and the Lord is the driver. The Lord keeps telling you, go this way, go this way. No, we go this way. It's called sin. It's called disobedience. We do the opposite of what the Lord says. And a policeman sees us. And we're driving all over the road. We're running on the sidewalk, knocking over stop signs, and, you know, just being a terror. The police pulls us over. and says, "Sir, I'm going to have to impound this car. This car is going to the impound lot." So the police calls the tow truck, tows the car away. Now, it wasn't the driver's fault. It was the car that was doing things his own way. But now the car has been taken away. And now the car belongs to the county, the city, whoever it is that towed the car away. And in order to reclaim the car, the owner has to go to the impound lot and pay. He owns the car, but he has to redeem the car. You understand? Yes? Not like this, if you get it. That's redemption. It's paying money to get something back that you own anyway. But because of what the thing did that was wrong, it got taken away. Our sin caused us to be in bondage to the enemy, to sin. And what did God have to do? Had to pay the price of redemption. That redemption was the own precious blood of Jesus Christ. That's how Jesus dealt with sin. So he paid the price. And it says there in Romans, I believe it's chapter 6, I believe it's verse 10, Jesus paid the price once for all. One trip to the cross, one trip to the Calvary, one Holy Week, one Passion, once for all of us, one sacrifice for all men. That was the redemption price, and that freed us from the bondage of sin. Now we can get back to the fold of the Father where we belong. That's the first way that the Lord dealt with sin. Now, the second way that the Lord dealt with sin, not only did he free us, not only did he redeem us, but he gave us grace to overcome sin and to live the life of God. This is what happens in Easter and baptism. In baptism, it says, and I won't take the time to read all the scriptures, but understand Romans chapter 6 from verse 1 all the way down to really the whole chapter, but especially down to verse 11, tells us that we have been united with Christ in his death. And we will also be united with him in his resurrection. So he said, if we've been united to him in his death, we should be dead to sin. We're not only forgiven for our sins, but we are given power over sin that we don't have to keep sinning. See, that's what we think sometimes in Lent. Okay, we understand sin, but we also understand now that in Easter we've been forgiven, so we can sin a bit and it doesn't matter. Remember what I said before, sin matters because it hurts people. The goal of God was never just pay for all the sins so you can do it all you want. Paul said, what can we say? Now that grace abounds, should we also, it's okay to sin so that grace will abound more? He said, may it never be. The old King James says, God forbid. That's not the message of Easter. The message of Easter is sin is dealt with, which means we have power to overcome sin and to loose the bonds of sin, or the bonds have been loosed. In Psalm 116, there in the second part of verse 16, which we read a little while ago, it said, you have loosed my bonds. What bonds? To death? Yes. To sin? Yes. Because death was there because of sin. Jesus not only paid the price of sin, but through his death, we are united with that death, so we also can die to sin. We're united in his resurrection, so we also can live to new life. He has loosed the bonds of sin on us. We couldn't do it. He did. We couldn't pay the price because we weren't sinless. He did. Lived a sinless life, and paid the price, not for his sin, but for our sin. And in so doing, he set us free. Read through that in Romans, and you'll see. He says several times, you're free from sin. He who has died to sin shouldn't be sinning any longer. Several other passages, which I'll just let you know about. In Colossians chapter 1, it says you're seated on high with Christ. So it says if you're seated on high, reject the things of the old nature. Reject the things of the sin nature. You're now born again in baptism. You're now born again to a new life, the life that Christ lived, to his divine nature. See, the divine nature of Christ is there for us, according to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. You've been given an opportunity to share in the divine nature. The divine nature did not sin. Even the human nature of Christ did not sin. And we've been given the grace to share his human nature. When he lived that sinless life, and rose, he made that available to us so we can share that sinless human nature, which was affected by that divine nature and now elevates human nature to something that it wasn't before. We can share with that. We can bear with it. We can join in with that. We can bear that same nature so that we also are not bound to sin, not bound to commit the same sins over and over and over and be unable to be free. You have loosed my bonds. This is, again, the message of Easter. And again, I want to illustrate, third illustration to help us explain. One illustration, the difference between 180 degrees, 360. Another illustration of redemption, like a car being redeemed out of the impound lot. It belongs to you, but it has to be paid a redemption price. That's what Jesus did. Illustration of how the Lord has set us free from sin, free from human weakness, free from human immaturity. Let's say you have a baby, all right? We call ourselves sometimes when we're newly born again, baby Christians. Babies don't know everything. Remember what I said, building is a process? Building up Christ's nature in us is a process. One of the things babies have to learn to do, not even the first day, usually not even the first year. Sometimes it takes, a baby has to be more than a year before he can learn to be potty trained, right? Little babies just don't know what to do with those bowel movements. So they just let them go. Now, equate that with sin. Human weakness, human immaturity. God could say, go ahead and just let it go wherever you want, and I'll clean it up. I'll change your diaper. If you're not wearing a diaper, I'll fix everything else. I'll just take care of it for you because I love you so much. And he does. But would not a deeper